Castle's contributions to air power date back to the early 40s. Men and women who have trained here have served in numerous wars and campaigns that the United States has been engaged in since World War II. It is through efforts such as theirs that America has remained free and her strength unchallenged. With the closure of Castle comes an end to a chapter that spans some 54 years. Castle's beginnings date back to the spring of 1941, when the commander of the Army Air Force's West Coast Training Center decided to expand operations from Moffett Field and to search for a suitable location for a flying school. Earlier in February of 1940, leading citizens of Merced encouraged the Army to build an installation in the area. 40 businessmen pledged $1,000 each toward the purchase of land for the base. The group of businessmen agreed to lease the land to the U.S. government for $1 a year. Over a year had passed and the government still had not decided on the location for the flying school. But in spring of 1941, after receiving a letter from the superintendent of the Merced Municipal Airport, the commander of the West Coast Training Center decided to send a few men to take a look at the area. Lee Barrett, then a lieutenant with the Army Air Corps, instructing in the BT-13, was chosen to look Merced over and report back with what he thought of the area.
I reported May 29th of 1941 to Moffett Field, taught 6 classes of students there, and was advised after that by our commander that Moffett was going to go back to the Navy. Had been the original owner of that area anyway. That was at San Jose. So my squadron commander, told me to take some friends and fly over and take a peek at Merced and Chico, that they were going to open those bases for Army Air Force training. So I got 5 other chaps and 6 of us come over, and we landed over here at the municipal airport. It's on Beechcraft Drive and Olive Avenue, an old lumber yard there now. And it was the only place that had pavement to shoot landings. And then looked around and got in our aircraft and flew up and looked Chico over. And due to the location of Merced, old versus Yosemite perhaps, and San Francisco, we decided we'd rather stay here. Now all of us agreed. And that's where we got the assignment.
On June 30th, 1941, the War Department formally notified the mayor of Merced that the site northwest of Merced had been approved. Construction began early in September of 1941, and on September 20th, the Army Air Corps named the new base the Air Corps Basic Flying School. In October, Merced leased its municipal airport to the Air Corps, giving the Basic Flying School its first usable auxiliary field. In late October of 1941, a small cadre of personnel were sent to Merced to set up a military project office. These men initially set up quarters at the Hotel Tioga. Colonel Joseph P. Bailey, the installation's first commander, temporarily set up his headquarters here. On December 1st, 1941, personnel at the Hotel Tioga were moved onto the new installation. One day later, the West Coast Training Center moved the units of Moffett Field to Merced, and military personnel first occupied the Air Corps Basic Flying School. As these men planned flight training of aviation cadets in Merced, Japanese pilots were going over plans for the bombing of Pearl Harbor. December 7, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, bringing the United States into World War II. Later that day, about 300 military and civilians assembled at the base, and Colonel Bailey ordered the 13 BT-15s and 21 BT-13s flown to the school from nearby Merced Municipal Airport. All over the United States, people listened in disbelief as President Roosevelt addressed Congress and a stunned nation. On December 20th, the first group of aviation cadets, 94 students, arrived for training at the flying school. The early curriculum included some 191 hours of training, 29 hours of basic maneuvers, 12 hours of instrument training, and 15 hours in a link trainer, to mention a few. John Blair, a lieutenant in the Army Air Corps at the time, instructed aviation cadets in the link trainer.
This is the link trainer, which was used in the early 1940s when we were flying aviation cadets in Merced Army Airfield. This was the instrument training that we had, a training simulator. In those days, we basically flew by the ball airspeed and the vertical horizon indicator. Those were the basic instruments that we had in those days. We had to spend, both the flying instructors and the cadets had to spend training hours in the link trainer. This was part of the curriculum for the aviation cadets, along with their flight training. My fondest memories of Merced Army Airfield was a camaraderie that went on among the pilots and the enlisted personnel and the aviation cadets. The camaraderie and the morale was very great at Merced Army Flying School. I remember a funny story. We were flying out of Potter Field, which is west of Merced, which is an auxiliary field. And I happened to be standing in the middle of the aprons, where stage houses they were called. And I was standing there talking to the two aviation cadets. And I happened to see this BT-13, and Lieutenant Lumley was the instructor flying. I noticed it wasn't making the S turns, which we were required to do for safety reasons. You couldn't see over the nose of the airplane while on the ground. So we noticed there were no S turns, and he passed the stage house, and he was on a microphone just chewing this cadet out about something. And about 200 feet down the way was an outhouse that they had at the auxiliary field. And the airplane just went straight into this outhouse. The prop was chewing into the outhouse. The door flew open, and out came an aviation cadet pulling up his flight suit, staggering and stumbling around trying to get his flight suit up. So ever after that, Lumley and the squadron was commonly called Outhouse Lumley.
During the first year of World War II, the Air Corps Basic Flying School was graduating 1,000 aviation cadets every 5 weeks. These young men would go on to advanced training in aircraft that would win fame in battles against the Luftwaffe, the Zeros, and the Kamikaze. The training that these men received in the flying school at Merced and others like it throughout the country would help write a chapter in air power history that would bring nations to the realization that air supremacy would ensure victory. In April of 1942, the West Coast Training Center looked for other ways to expand the mission at Merced. On the 7th of April, the Air Corps Basic Flying School was renamed Merced Army Flying School. 400 new flight recruits were assigned to the school for basic military training. In January of 1943, two more training squadrons were activated, and in May of that same year, the Merced Army Flying School changed its name once again, this time to Merced Army Airfield. Operations increased as the war dragged on. General Henry Half Arnold, commanding general of the Army Air Forces, recognized that pilots were going to be needed in large numbers early in the war. With his encouragement, a women's branch of the Army Air Forces was organized. They were known as the Women Army Service Pilots, or better known as the WASP. The first of 156 WASP to be stationed at Merced Field arrived in November of 1943. Over the next few months, the WASP flew as test pilots, towed aerial targets, and ferried aircraft to other bases to help Merced's military instructors. These women did a tremendous job during the war. Their contributions freed many Army service pilots for combat duty. May of 1944 brought the PT-17 to Merced Field for single-engine advanced training. There were hints that the AT-6 Texan could soon be assigned. The first AT-6s landed at Merced in mid-July 1944 and entered use in October at the start of Class 45A. As January of 1945 approached, combat veterans began returning to Merced Field. In February, the last 171 cadets were sent to other fields for training, and pre-flight training ended at Merced Field. With the Allied victory in Europe, Merced Field and many other training bases faced closure. On June 29, 1945, the remaining 253 training aircraft were transferred out, and on June 30th, the Army Air Force discontinued the Pilot Basic School, bringing to a close a training program that by June of 1945 had provided 8,699 pilots to the Army Air Force. The 4th Air Force assumed jurisdiction of the field on July 1st, 1945. Construction of a new runway began with plans to stage the B-29 Superfortress and crews out of Merced. However, construction ceased in August when the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, resulting in the eventual surrender of Japan. In the 3 years and 8 months America had been at war, air power had played a significant role in bringing World War II to a close and to restoring peace to the world. The role that air power would play in maintaining this peace was just beginning. With the war over and construction of the new runway canceled, Merced Army Airfield's future was uncertain. The mayor of Merced, along with local community leaders, traveled to Washington. Here they met with such military leaders as General Hap Arnold, Lieutenant General Ira Eaker, and even President Truman, and lobbied to keep the base open. Their efforts paid off, and in October 1945, the 1st Staging Command opened its doors at the field. November saw the arrival of the B-29 Superfortress, Mitchell B-25, the C-45 Expediter, the C-47 Skytrain, the L-5 Sentinel, and the AT-6 Texan, as the 444th Bombardment Group came to life. With renewed activity at the base, the Army Air Force planned to rename the base after a fallen hero of World War II, Brigadier General Frederick W. Castle. It was December 24, 1944. General Castle was flying a B-17, leading the 3rd Air Division against the Germans. His aircraft came under attack by a single Messerschmitt Bf-109. As the fighter pumped cannon shells into the flying fortress, 6 more 109s came in for the kill, spraying gunfire into the crippled fortress and setting 2 engines on fire. Even with 2 engines on fire, General Castle refused to order the bombs dropped because of friendly troops below. Lowering the landing gear to slow the airspeed, he ordered his men to bail out with the message, "This is it, boys." Determined to be the last one to leave, General Castle rode the plane to 1,200 feet before a fuel tank exploded, plunging the plane and killing General Castle. Merced Army Airfield was renamed Castle Field on January 1, 1946. And a few months later, at a ceremony on April 6th, General Hap Arnold officially christened Castle Field at the Granite Dedication Monument, now located at the base parade grounds. Colonel Bernie Lay, who served under General Castle and went on to later write the novel 12 O'Clock High, wrote this inscription. "The heart is torn of late by the almost daily reports of heroes killed in action. Botcher, Prady, and now Castle. They all seem to have been made from a knightly stamp, gallant and chivalrous. Men who the gods themselves will welcome. Brigadier General Castle, killed while leading an air division of B-17s over Europe, lived in Washington. He had earned a rare distinction among the younger Air Corps generals. No man can say how far it is to the top of the sky, but those who have fought the enemy in the blue upper levels where the vapor trails from, where the mist between life and death is thin, believe that men like Castle fly on at that higher altitude from which none return to Earth." Earlier in 1946, Castle Field added to its inventory of aircraft 4 B-17s, operating 2 for staging to the Far East Air Forces and 2 as the 59th Reconnaissance Squadron arrived in February of that year. In April 1946, the 15th Air Force assumed jurisdiction of Castle and in June transferred the 93rd Bombardment Group to Castle. In mid-1946, the base was plagued with manning reductions and unit inactivations. The 93rd Bombardment Group maintained its existence throughout September with only 2 people assigned. 15th Air Force placed Castle in minimum operating status in October of 1946 with only minimum manning. In November of 1946, the Army Air Force inactivated all remaining units at Merced, placing the base in a caretaker status. Castle reopened late in May of 1947 under the Strategic Air Command. Restructuring and reorganizing units began almost immediately. On July 28, 1947, the 93rd Bombardment Wing, operating with the B-29 Superfortress, activated at Castle Field. 3 bombardment squadrons, the 328, 329, and 330th, were assigned to the wing. The wing took on the numerical designation of the highly decorated World War II unit, the 93rd Bombardment Group. The group, while operating with B-24 Liberators, earned 2 Distinguished Unit Citations during the war. First for delivering severe bombing blows to enemy supply and communication targets from 1942 to 1943, and the second for the group's role in the famed Alesti Oil Refinery Raid in 1943. The group commander and pilot, Lieutenant Colonel Addison E. Baker, and his co-pilot, Major John L. Gerstad, received the Congressional Medal of Honor posthumously for their heroism during the raid. September 18, 1947 saw the birth of a new independent branch of the service, as Stuart Simonton was sworn in as the first Secretary of the United States Air Force. On January the 13th, 1948, SAC redesignated the installation with its current name, Castle Air Force Base. March of 49, Castle acquired the 93rd Air Refueling Squadron, with plans to start training for a new concept just recently introduced, boom air refueling. In May, all B-29s were shipped out of the castle to prepare for the arrival of the new B-50 superfortress. In October of 1949, with these new superfortresses, Castle's bomber crews entered SAC's second annual bombing competition, walking away with top honor. The KB-29s arrived late in 1950, and the 93rd Air Refueling Squadron entered training to give Castle a new mission, to refuel bombers in flight. This would increase the range of SAC's bombers and redefine the use of air power. With the hot war over and the cold war just beginning, Castle was once again at the forefront in training, providing air crews who would be part of a deterrent force that would serve for nearly four decades. October of 1953 saw Castle's mission change once again. With the introduction of the KC-97 Stratotanker in December of 53, tactical air refueling responsibilities were replaced by training crews to complete their B-50 refueling training requirements. The same month, 15th Air Force eliminated Castle's tactical mission and tasked the 93rd Bombardment Wing to man, equip, and train Castle's bomber units for the B-47 Stratojet. 26 May 1954, the first two B-47s arrived on base and were subsequently christened in a ceremony naming them the City of Merced and the City of Avon. During this same time frame, the Boeing Aircraft Company had under production a new jet bomber, the B-52 Stratofortress. SAC planned to use these B-47 crews to train in the upcoming B-52. January of 1955, SAC activated the 417th Training Squadron, later becoming the 417th Combat Crew Training Squadron. June of 55, Castle became the first base to receive the B-52 Stratofortress. The B-52s will become a familiar sight in Central California for decades to come. During the mid to late 1950s, communist countries were massing huge armies and large arsenals of weapons. The threat they posed to the security of the United States was very real. Nuclear war, once only a dream, could now become a reality. It was imperative that the communist threat knew and understood America's strength. It was through weapon systems such as the B-52s and KC-97s at the time that this strength was demonstrated, and Castle bomber and tanker crews led the way. Once in a great while, a military organization gets a chance during peacetime to perform a great service to the nation and bring fame and glory unto itself. Such a chance came to the 93rd Bombardment Wing twice within 3 months, once in November of 1956 and again in January of 1957. November 24th and 25th, 1956, Operation Quick Kick. Castle B-52s from the 93rd Bombardment Wing were refueled by the 93rd Air Refueling Squadron, KC-97s. The refueling support provided by the KC-97s allowed the B-52s to carry out a flight that took them around North America. Earlier on November 10th, the Russian government had threatened to send what they called volunteers to oust British and French troops from the Middle East. These flights, hailed by the press as a warning to potential enemies, caused the Russian government to rethink their position and quietly drop the matter of sending these volunteers. January 16th, 1957, Operation Powerflight. Three B-52s from the 93rd Bombardment Wing set out from Castle Air Force Base to circle the globe. KC-97s from the 93rd Air Refueling Squadron once again worked with the B-52s, providing crucial air refueling support. On January 18th at 10:19 Pacific Standard Time, the first bomber landed back on California soil. It was exactly 45 hours and 19 minutes after the first bomber had taken off from Castle. The other two landed at 90-second intervals. 27 tired but excited men scrambled out of the aircraft to be met by friends and family. General Curtis E. LeMay was there to present each of the men the Distinguished Flying Cross for their efforts and contributions to this historical and biggest aviation accomplishment of the time. These flights ensured the message of America's strength and her determination for freedom was clearly heard. Once again, Castle and her crews made a vital contribution to air power. June of 1957 saw the arrival of the all-jet tanker, the KC-135 Stratotanker. In 1958, the wing's KC-135s established two world records in Operation Jetstream. On April 7th and 8th, the 93rd Bombardment Wing KC-135 broke the nonstop speed record between Tokyo and Washington, D.C. in 13 hours, 45 minutes, and 46.5 seconds. They also broke the unrefueled flying distance record for a flight between Tokyo and the Azores. Air crews were going to be needed for this new SAC asset, and where better to train them than Castle? July 1st, 1959 saw the activation of the 924th Air Refueling Squadron. This squadron assumed responsibility for KC-135 aircrew training. The 93rd Air Refueling Squadron at the same time resumed full-time air refueling, continuing their tactical missions. Over the years, the two air refueling squadrons would work together both training and operating KC-135 crews. Throughout the next 30 years, the two squadrons would share duties of both training KC-135 crews and in flying operational missions. With early leadership from men such as Colonel Douglas H. Smith, Lieutenant Colonel John A. Decker, and Lieutenant Colonel Edward B. Fitch, these squadrons would be part of many air refueling firsts. Among these were Operation Thirsty Dart, the in-flight test of the air refueling capability of the F-106. Operation Heat Rise, aerial refueling for the B-58 speed record flight, and Operation Glass Brick, an air refueling and logistics support mission for the first B-58 to land in the Far East. From the late 1960s to the early 70s, Castle supported the Vietnam effort by conducting D-model B-52 training for crew members deploying to Southeast Asia. They participated in Young Tiger, which utilized KC-135 aircraft in the priority airlift of support personnel and augmentation crews to and from Western Pacific bases, as well as providing air refueling support. May of 1973 brought the 84th Fighter Interceptor Squadron to Castle operating with F-106s. This squadron would carry on the air defense operations that the 456th Squadron started at Castle back in October of 1955. Castle's role in air defense operations began with the F-86 Sabre jet and continued through the conversion to the F-102 Delta Dagger and the F-106 Delta Dart until the 456th deactivated in July of 1968. The 84th would operate out of Castle from the mid-70s until the late 80s. In 1983, F-15s from the 318th Fighter Interceptor Squadron were sent from McCord Air Force Base in Washington to assume the air defense alert commitment of the 84th. February of 1987, the 84th Fighter Interceptor Squadron was inactivated, ending Castle's role in air defense operations. 93rd Bomb Wing's most recent involvement in special operations was in 1990 through 1991 with operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm. The wing ran a shuttle service, Desert Express, where crews from Castle and other bases transported people, supplies, and equipment to forward operating locations. The 93rd Bomb Wing deployed over 650 personnel. The wing's crews flew over 200 combat missions and over 500 support missions. Several B-52 crew members were decorated for their efforts during Desert Storm. Major Linwood Mason, Jr. received the Silver Star for his heroism in action when his B-52 was damaged by enemy artillery during a low-level bombing mission over Iraq. Captain Timothy P. Halpin received the Distinguished Flying Cross for his efforts in helping a flight of B-52s avoid a surface-to-air missile and for assisting in the safe recovery of a damaged B-52 that was unable to avoid the missile. Castle has undergone many changes in its recent history, from the deactivation of several squadrons, introduction of new commands, and to the forming of an operations group as a tenant unit. Castle's efforts, contributions, and winning team spirit over the years has been superb. The communities of Merced and Atwater have long been a part of this team spirit. But it's more than trophies and awards that set Castle apart, it's her people. Men and women who train, fly, and fight. Maintenance people who keep them flying. Services people who keep them fed. And many more, so numerous to mention. On May 3rd, 1994, the last B-52 to be stationed at Castle rolled down the runway, lifted off, and flew its last flight over the California skies. What had become a familiar sight in Central California for nearly four decades faded into memory as the last B-52G made its way to retirement at Davis-Monthan Air Force Base in Arizona. Brigadier General Select Silas R. Johnson, Jr., the 93rd Bomb Wing Commander, piloted the aircraft. He left the men and women at Castle with these words. Although this machine retires, the spirit of quality which made her and others like her the most potent bomber in the world continues on in each of you. Operations, maintenance, support, and community working together as Team Castle have made the nearly 40 years of B-52 operations a resounding success. The training program for B-52 crews has been relocated to Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana. KC-135 combat crew training will continue at Castle until February of 1995, when the last KC-135 is scheduled to depart the base. The training program will be relocated to Altus Air Force Base in Oklahoma. But the tanker's departure ends a history of aircrew training that has been associated with Castle since its opening in December of 1941. Castle Air Force Base will officially close in September of 1995.
The story of Castle is more than the story of an Air Force Base. It's the story of a journey where people and machines have served this great nation, training, flying, and fighting. Few people can claim to have made as great a contribution to America's defense as the men and women of Team Castle. As you saw, Frederick Castle sacrificed his life during World War II, and he was awarded the Medal of Honor. The 93rd has a prominent history. It ended Nazi petroleum production at Plessy, and we sustained that legacy of honor through Vietnam, where our bombers and tankers brought the Vietnamese to the negotiating table. These conflicts are eclipsed by the longest of all wars in our American history, the Cold War, which came to an end because of the mission of the men and women of Castle Air Force Base. During the liberation of Kuwait, we redefined modern warfare. Castle will always be known as the fountainhead of air power. Let the record show that Castle is where global reach and global power began. Through it all, our people have demonstrated professionalism and upheld the honor of America. Today is a very proud day. As we march forward together, it's a day to be tough-minded and tender-hearted, resolute and looking toward a bright future with a contentment in our hearts that we have accomplished in the past. Castle's people have been fortunate to live between two great cities. Our local communities aren't just our neighbors. For over 53 years, they've been our family. It's time to be thankful for the opportunity to have served this great nation together. Military and community, one family. The endeavors undertaken at Castle Air Force Base reflect the highest of human values, commitment, sharing, sacrifice, and love. The members of Castle and our community family have reason to be proud, for few people ever make such a profound contribution in the ever-changing world where we live. We can all be proud of being part of Castle Air Force Base. I wish all of the members of the Castle family the best of luck and Godspeed.
As we reflect on the many contributions Castle and her people have made over the years, realizing there is much to do in the months ahead, perhaps there is none better to sum up the feelings of Castle's upcoming closure than Helen McCartney. Helen has worked with the men and women of Castle for over 37 years. She is known not only on the base, but throughout the community as well.
I always remind those who are leaving to look up the words of a song that was very popular during World War II, and that was my favorite, and was called I'll Be Seeing You. That I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. And that small cafe, the park across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut tree, the laughing well. And I'll be seeing you in every lovely summer's day and everything that's bright and gay. I'll always think of you that way, and I'll find you in the morning sun. And when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you.